Yesterday we have seen the summary of the layers. The summary of the layers provides us the information about every layer for the OSI model. The configuration that is associated with the OSI model, consisting of physical layer, data link layer, network layer, transport layer, session layer, presentation layer, application layer. The sequence is quite easy to remember. Lowest layer is always a physical layer. Lowest layer is a physical layer. Just above it, it's the data or a link that needs to be created in between source and destination. The link is from the network, where the network helps in carrying the data to the transport. And for transporting, a session needs to be created where data must be in a presentable form, which is created by the application. That summarizes the OSI 7 layers. The OSI 7 layers, though we are saying that the properties that are associated, it's the standard. OSI is a standard. So it refers to the open system interconnection. The open system interconnection provides us the facility that the boundaries associated with the layers are somewhat strict whenever the standards are defined. Whenever the standards are defined, the boundaries or the services that are provided by the layer to the either upper layer or the lower layer are always fixed. That's why we can say that OSI has the strict boundaries. Every layer works independently and in synchronization with the adjacent layers, either the upper layer or the lower layer. But in the standards, OSI always suggests strict boundaries. And that's why it's also known as a vertical approach. Vertical approach, which follows a specified hierarchical structure. The configuration developed or the model that is being developed also supports the connection oriented or connectionless type of services, but the boundaries are quite defined in case of OSI model, and that's one of the advantage whenever the developer follows the layered architecture in developing the data connections or data configurations. Another model that is utilized by the industry is typically known as a TCP/IP protocol suite. This TCP/IP protocol suite is the de facto standard that we are utilizing nowadays. The OSI model we just looked is just a reference or a logical model. It was designed to describe the functions of the communication system by dividing the communication procedures into smaller layered components. But when we talk about the TCP/IP model, the TCP/IP model initially was developed by Department of Defense, US, and that's why it's also known as a DoD type of model, Department of Defense, DoD. It was quite earlier developed. In 1960s, the development of the DoD model was actually started, but it was not at all standardized. It actually stands for Transmission Control Protocol / Internet Protocol. It's a concise version of the OSI model. It consists of four layers. The four layers suggested in the OSI typically, or rather five layers, out of which physical layer nowadays is not at all considered. And that's why the remaining layers, the four layers, consist of the data link layer, the network layer, the transport layer, and the application layer. There are various names for these four different layers. The application layer in the TCP/IP model is also known as a process layer, or it's a process / application layer. Then the transport layer in the TCP/IP model is typically known as a host to host layer, a host to host / transport layer. Then the next layer is the network layer, The network layer is typically known as the internet layer. Internetworking was initially suggested in the TCP/IP model, and that's why the network layer is typically known as the internet layer. And the fourth layer, the network access or the link layer, that is suggested in the OSI model. The properties that are associated with the network layer or suggested in the network layer, the properties of some of the properties associated with the physical layer are combined in this data link layer or network access layer. These are the typical four layers. Physical layer is not at all considered. Again, TCP/IC also does not suggest what type of devices are to be utilized at the physical layer. But it also identifies the typical configurations of the communication devices. The communication devices are actually classified again as communication equipments used at the transmitter end, communication equipments used for interfacing, communication equipments used for propagating at transmitter end and at the receiving end, the interfacing at transmitter as well as at the receiving end. But again, TCP/IP protocol suite also does not suggest you what type of devices are to be utilized. What type of devices are to be utilized, that is never suggested in a standard. And whenever we are calling it as a model, this particular model, TCP or DoD model or TCP/IP model, also does not suggest what type of devices are to be utilized. But it necessarily suggests what type of protocol stack is required for every layer. This particular configuration associated with the TCP/IP layer, we can compare the OSI model and the TCP/IP model. The three different layers, the physical, the data link, the network layer, the transport layer, the session layer, the presentation layer, and the application layer. These are the seven layers associated or suggested in the OSI model. Out of these, the physical and data link actually forms host to network layer of a TCP/IP model. The protocols are defined by the host to network layer. The physical and data link layer that is suggested in the OSI model is actually constituting the lowermost layer, that is host to network, and that's why the devices are never suggested. Then the upper layer is the IP layer, or it's the internet protocol layer. The four different important protocols that are utilized whenever the internet layer for TCP/IC module is talked is to utilize the address resolution protocol, ARP protocol. And whenever we are talking about the address resolution protocol, if we want to automate the address resolution, the sum of the facilities that are suggested in the IP layer are by utilizing the reverse address resolution protocol, RARP, the ARP protocol and the RARP protocol. These two protocols are quite important protocols in identifying, communicating, forming a network, forming a topology with the support of the TCP/IP model. Then two control protocols that are suggested in the internet protocol for the TCP/IP model are the ICMP protocol, Internet Control Message Protocol, and Internet Gateway Message Protocols, out of which ICMP is typically utilized to provide the synchronization, to provide the error correction, to provide the additional facilities necessary at the network level synchronization. Then at the transport layer, the most common protocols that are suggested are the TCP protocol and the UDP protocol. The TCP protocol at the transport layer provides us transmission control strategies associated with the packets, and that's why the name TCP protocol. Whenever the connectivity is a wired type of connective, we are typically utilizing the procedures that are suggested in the TCP/IP protocol. Whenever it's a wireless, or rather we call it as a connectionless type of configuration, in case of connectionless type of configuration, the protocol that is suggested at the transport layer is the user datagram protocol. The user datagram protocol actually helps in formulating the datagram. At the same time, one additional protocol that was suggested in the DoD model in order to provide the bulk translation of the data from one end to another end, and that's nowadays we typically utilize for the video conferencing, and that particular protocol that is known as a Stream Control Transmission Protocol, SCTP, Stream Control Transmission Protocol. These are some of the important protocols that are based on the TCP/IP model, and mostly these protocols are used in practice. The Stream Control Transmission Protocol helps many types of communication, such as a unicast type of communication. The typical example is, again, I have given you the video conferencing, or if it's a video on demand, whatever you are utilizing for YouTube. For YouTube, you are invoking the YouTube site in your browser. Your browser becomes a client for YouTube, and your client is utilizing the Stream Control Transmission Protocol used by YouTube in order to translate the video information, in order to translate video information from the server to the client. And that's why stream control is required. The stream control is always required in real time for the applications such as video conferencing. The buffering should not at all be there in case of the real time transmission protocol. And that's why nowadays, for this transport mechanism, many more protocols are being developed, which utilizes the various configurations that were suggested in 1960 in the DoD model. Actually, this particular TCP/IP model was more prominent or more dominant whenever the internet was started. Before that, for the client-server type of configuration, there were two major giants. The two major giants, typically Microsoft and Novell NetWare. Novell NetWare was utilizing some of the facilities that are suggested in the OSI model and some of the facilities that are suggested in the TCP/IP model. The uppermost layer consists of the three different layers which are suggested in the OSI model: the session layer, presentation layer, and the application layer. Many more application protocols are developed based on the facilities that are suggested in the TCP/IP model. The most important modules that we are nowadays utilizing are the typically HTTP protocols, FTP protocols, HTTP Hypertext Transfer Protocol, File Transfer Protocol FTP, Simple Mail Transfer Protocol, Simple Network Management Protocol, then it's the Telnet, which provides the remote configuration, remote administrations of the devices was possible by providing the connectivity with the remote systems. And such protocols, such many more protocols are available at the application layer. The application layer suggested by the TCP/IP helps us in developing the various web client server based systems. Web client server based system, that means you need to have only one browser which will support the internet working, and with the help of the MIMEs that are suggested for the browser, each and every application, the data can be exchanged with the support of the client server configuration under TCP/IP. And that's why TCP/IP is very, very popular protocol. The TCP/IP model is supposed to be a de facto standard nowadays. Whenever we talk about the differences in the TCP/IP protocol, the TCP refers to the transmission control protocol, whereas OSI refers to the open system interconnection. The TCP/IP protocol has four layers. If we consider physical layer, then these are five layers, but OSI has fixed seven layers. The TCP IP is said to be more reliable because the translation or efficiency suggested by the various standards in the TCP/IP model helps us in delivering the packets efficiently towards the destination end, and that's why the TCP/IP protocol is said to be more reliable protocol than the OSI model. This is one of the major difference. Just now I have given you the example associated with the boundaries in the OSI model. In case of OSI model, there are strict boundaries. So whenever the functions associated with the network layer are seen for the OSI model, then these functions are related specifically to the deployment of that particular layer, the syntax associated with that particular layer, and only the interfacing with the adjacent layers. So there are strict boundaries, and that's why it's a vertical approach. But TCP/IP does not follow such strictness associated with the boundaries, and that is the major difference. And that's why TCP/IP is supposed to be following a horizontal approach. Horizontal approach itself provides us quite a flexibility in the suggested model. The TCP/IP protocol, the transport layer in the TCP/IP does not provide actually the assurance of the delivery of the packet. Whereas whenever we are defining the standards always say that the transport layer always provides the assurance for the delivery of the packets. But in case of transport layer for the TCP/IP, that is transmission control protocol, or the UDP protocol, does not provide assurance. It says that your data will be reaching to the destination end, but it's not at all the assurance from the specified transport layer. Nowadays we are utilizing the devices that actually provides us the specific assurance associated with the delivery of the packets. But initially, whenever DoD protocol was suggested, while comparing to the OSI model, the TCP/IP protocol does not provide assurance associated with the delivery of the packet. The TCP model only provides the connection-less type of configuration. Now, whenever we are considering the UDP type of configuration, a connection-less as well as a connection-oriented configuration was initially suggested in the DoD model. At present also, we are utilizing connection-oriented as well as the connection-less models that are suggested in the TCP/IP model. But the protocol stack for the OSI model is quite a standardizer. Because it's a standard, OSI model is supposed to be a standard. The protocol stack for every defined protocol is always a fixed one. And that is one of the limitations that is associated with the OSI model. Whereas the protocol stack for the TCP/IP is not at all a fixed one. There is always a shuffling. There is always a shuffling in the functions that are supported at the data link layer and the functions that are supported at the network layer. Some control facilities are always included in the data link layer that are supported for host to network configuration in the TCP/IP model. So these are some of the differences that are supported for the TCP/IP model. The TCP/IP model, actually, whenever we are talking about the lowest layer, host to network layer, this again layer corresponds to the combination of data link layer and physical layer of OSI model. So the facilities that are suggested in the OSI as well as the OSI model are always the de facto standard, which looks out for the addressing. We have seen that addressing, error correction, then those were the facilities that were identified in case of the OSI model. Similar are the facilities that are utilized for the network access layer or host to network layer. Whenever we are talking about the functions, in case of OSI model, we have seen that there is a separate encapsulation. There is a separate header that is being added. Here we can say that the combined physical and data link layer headers are added for the data that is being carried with the support of host to network layer. And that simplifies the operation that is associated with the host to network layer. Then the internet layer, IP layer. This IP layer parallels to the functions of network layer, the network layer for the OSI model. The logical transmission of the data, the logical transmission, we have seen that the upper four layers are typically peer-to-peer connected. Every function, every primitive associated with the upper four layer of the OSI model is actually guaranteeing the peer-to-peer services for, or it's a virtual type of interconnection in between the upper four layers. The main protocol residing in the TCP/IP network layer is the IP protocol. It's the internet protocol and responsible for delivering the packets from source to the destination by looking into the IP address. Here, the concept of IP address was initially suggested. This IP address when then standardized to two different standards, IP version 4 and IP version 6. These are the two standards that are used by most websites. The IP version 4 is almost utilized by every website. IP version 6 is still not so common, but it has been introduced. Then another protocol that is utilized, ICMP protocol. The ICMP stands for Internet Control Message Protocol. It actually is responsible for providing host with the information about the network problem. It's a control protocol. So all problems associated with the IP layer, all problems associated with the IP layer are taken care by ICMP protocol. The important protocol that I have told you, address resolution protocol, which the job of this particular protocol is to find the hardware address of a host from a known IP address configuration. There are different varieties that are associated with ARP protocol. The RARP is another variety of the ARP protocol, reverse address resolution protocol. Then proxy ARP, that's one more additional layer or type of a address resolution protocol. Then it's inverse ARP and gratuitous ARP. Nowadays we are not at all utilizing, but whenever internet protocol was suggested, it was the resolution supported by interrelation of the systems. Nowadays this particular concept is not at all used, since the large number of systems are available for interconnection. That's why gratuitous address resolution protocol concept is nowadays outdated from the TCP/IP module. Just concepts of ARP and RARP are typically utilized. Whenever we go to the upper layer, instead of HTTP, typically for streaming control, it's a control protocol. But for actual transmission, host-to-host delivery, we are utilizing TCP and UDP protocol. TCP is known to provide reliable and error-free communication between the end system, host-to-host system. It's a reliable, end-to-end, error-free communication. Then, for performing this, it will perform the sequencing task, it will perform the segmentation task, it also acknowledges the various features, and at the same time also supports the flow control. All these were suggested at the data link layer, if you recall it. But now here those facilities are added in the network layer. The network layer, the transmission control protocol, the flow control mechanism. It's a very effective type of protocol. We can say the TCP protocol is the most effective type of protocol. The overheads, if you are adding for this transmission control protocol, actually increases the cost of communication. And that's why TCP is always kept in a simple operational way, which minimizes the cost. And that's why the TCP/IP protocol is very popular type of protocol. Then another part in the transport layer for the TCP/IP model is the UDP. It's a user datagram protocol. The UDP does not provide any feature associated with the TCP. It is a protocol where when the systems, the source system does not require a reliable transmission, does not require, just remember these words, does not require a reliable transmission. Whenever we are talking about this, it drastically reduces the cost of the communication, and that's why it's a very cost effective. So once a data is dumped, the sender does not care whether the data is reaching towards the destination or not. But since the addressing associated with the packets is properly maintained, a huge amount of, huge chunk of the data can be transmitted in a cost effective way with the support of user datagram protocol. Then the application layer. The application layer, just now I have told you the various applications that we are utilizing nowadays. These applications constitute the standards that are suggested in the three layers: session layer, presentation layer, and application layer for the OSI model. But the number of protocols that are utilized at the application layer have helped in enlarging the network of the network, and that's why millions of systems are daily added in the network of network, becomes part of the data networking, and that is the success associated with this TCP/IP model, TCP/IP model of networking. This TCP/IP model of networking helps us in properly developing the various types of equipments. The various types of equipments. Once again, we will compare these network models. Why we require a network model? Why the layered architecture is required? And the two popular network models: Open System Interconnection and Department of Defense (DoD) model, or most commonly nowadays known as TCP model. Just we'll go through the slides very fast. OSI model, 7 layers. Forget about the upper lines, just concentrate on this particular part. This actually tells us the connectivity supported for hubs or switches, the type of transmission media connectors. Transmission media connectors will be different for the optical devices, transmission media connectors will be different for the electrical configurations, and the type of modems that are required. Whenever the first concept of dial-up configuration utilizing the switched telephone network was utilized as the major communication media for the OSI model, various types of equipments were developed based on the concepts that were suggested in the physical layer, and that gave rise to the manufacturing of the various types of modems. Nowadays, those dial-up type of modems are obsolete. We are not at all utilizing the dial-up type of modems, are changed into the DSL type of modem. The DSL type of modem, that is, these are the typical modems that are utilized for providing the broadband connectivity, where the DSL modem helps us in providing the connectivity of our existing communication media, existing public communication media, for a high speed data transfer. The DSL modem are the modem that are supported by every internet service provider, which provides you the specified high speed data connectivity, the specified high speed data connectivity, and that's why the modem that you see at home are typically the digital subscriber line or asynchronous digital subscriber line. DSL or ADSL type of modem configuration. Nowadays, for wireless as well as the wired type of connectivity, we are utilizing those DSL type of modem. Those are nowadays fully functioning and fully supporting the TCP/IP model. Remember here the specified configuration, the network connectivity hardware, switches and network interface board. For extending the networks, we are utilizing the network interface boards with a specified topology. The configuration associated with the network interface boards again differs. Typically, whenever we are utilizing the star type of topology, the switches are the devices. The switches are the devices that are utilized, and the practical protocols based on the data link layer protocol typically are the HDLC protocol and frame relay protocol. What are those? We will study whenever we go for unit 3. The devices that are used, the upper part we have already seen. The network layer defines logical network structure and addressing, route discovery and selection, network layer flow control and error control at the network layer, and the protocols that are suggested in the OSI model, IP protocol and IPX protocol, internet protocol switched, that is the IPX protocol. Then along with the IP protocol, similar to the TCP/IP model, previously we were utilizing IPX/SPX, Internet Protocol Exchange, Switch Protocol Exchange, SPX. This was the configuration that was supported by the novel network. The novel network were quite dominant up to 2010. Still, there are some proprietary networks. Those are utilizing novel network configuration for providing the client to server connectivity. The advantage was IPX/SPX model was dumb terminals were also utilized as the client, which were utilizing all the facilities that were controlled by the server. The type of protocol configuration, protocol suite that was utilized by the IPX/SPX network was entirely a client server, where dumb clients were interfacing with the server and were following all the facilities provided by the server. The type of connectivity or the type of topology that was suggested specifically for the IPX/SPX was the ring type of topology as well as the bus type of topology. Whenever the number of terminals are very less, the bus type of topology was utilized. Nowadays, novel has closed their business. They were not up to the mark. They were quite in the market up to 2006. They also translated their model to the TCP/IP model, but they were not at all successfully financially, and that's why Novell stopped their networking model, which was IPX/SPX type of model. But still, some networks where dumb terminals are utilized are utilizing this particular facility. The configurations or the protocols that are supported at the network layer, whenever we are talking about the TCP/IP model, the TCP protocol, SPX protocol, just now I have told you, and the user datagram protocol. At the transport layer, for the TCP/IP. Then again. Yesterday I have asked the question and didn't get the correct answer associated with the session layer. Session layer provides dialog control. Session layer provides synchronization. Synchronization helps in proper translation once a session is initiated, and that concept of data exchange is entirely guided by the session administration. That's the important functioning associated with the session layer. In the presentation layer, typically translation, encryption, compression, decompression, whenever the facilities that are used at the source end say encryption at the destination end, we need to have a decryption. Whenever it's encoded at the receiving end, it's a decoded. Whenever it's a compressed, it's a uncompression. Whenever it's zip data, unzip type of data at the receiving end. That, and the practical protocols, ASCII, American Standard Code for Information Interchange. Some are still utilizing EBCDIC models for defining the text numerals. Nowadays, everyone is following the ASCII standards. Every keyboard is actually supported by the ASCII model, and that's why each and every character, even including the special characters, can be assigned to the specified data, and that's typically a presentation layer protocol. Whenever we are typically talking about the image, a complex image model most commonly utilized in the world, JPEG. Whenever we are talking about the compressed video protocol that are utilized, MPEG standard, MP3, MP4, MP3 specifically for audio, MP4 for audio and video, MIDI, multimedia interface, the multimedia interface specifically for audio and video files. For the application layer, it supports the network services and the service advertisement. It tells the source as well as the destination what type of process-to-process communication is being established. And whenever the process-to-process, with the help of a additional addressing, that's what yesterday I have told you, four different types of addressing: the physical addressing, the logical addressing, the port addressing, and the application addressing. Whenever we are utilizing the port addressing, we are actually defining these ports. These ports are utilized to create a socket in source and destination, and with the help of suitable programming interface, once a socket is being established in the two systems, the socket is being established with the support of IP address and the port address at the source end, and the IP address and the port address at the destination end. That actually forms the socket. Once the socket is created, all sorts of application data can be interfaced. That's what we call it as the socket programming nowadays, but which utilizes the third type of addressing scheme, that is the port addressing. What is that? We'll again see in our last chapter. The DoD model, the TCP/IP model, again and again, I am dealing with this is to clear all the minute details associated with the OSI model and the TCP/IP model. We are going to see the details, all the details about the data link layer suggested at the TCP/IP model, suggested at the OSI model. Both we will be considering in our next unit, unit 3 and unit 4. The important tasks TCP does for you: file transfer, remote login, electronic mail, remote printing, remote execution, name and terminal services, network file systems. Whatever we have seen in the initial lectures, the advantages of computer networking or computer communication network. The TCP/IP overview, it provides the ability to facilitate communication and share resources. The TCP/IP are the two independent protocols. TCP, nowadays we can call it as the connection oriented protocol, IP as the connectionless protocol. IP is a routable protocol, meaning two nodes communicating through this IP address need not be physically on the same wire. That defines the different topology for different networks. I think for this particular first chapter, TCP/IP and the OSI model, we'll take a break. I will take the questions now. Stop sharing. I will take the questions. You can ask any type of question associated with the OSI model as well as the TCP/IP model. Much more details we'll study in our due course. Anyone can switch on the mic. Yes. Yes, Aishwarya.
Hello, sir.
Huh.
Hello.
Yes.
Hello.
Yes, you have any difficulty?
No, sir.
Komal Desai again.
No, sir.
Komal Desai.
Yes, sir.
Not attentive. Any doubt, any question?
No.
Siddhi.
No, sir.
How you will differentiate TCP and the transport protocol in the OSI model? Yes. Sushant, you can also give the answer. Transmission control protocol and the transport protocols in the OSI model. Transmission control protocol, the third layer of the TCP/IP model. Anurag Chaudhary. Mari. Anurag. Muskan. Muskan Mujawar. Prerna. Sifa, Neha Patil, you can talk by just unmute your mic. Anurag Chaudhary, again I will suggest to use a headset that the echo can be avoided. Mrunali. Anyone has questions? That means you are quite prepared for taking an exam. So we'll go for first assessment. If you don't have any questions, all the concepts are quite clear, then we will go for the first assessment. Are you ready for it? Nikhil Patil, what's your opinion?
Yes, sir.
What's your opinion? Yes, should we take exam tomorrow? Whatever we have studied up till now? Yes, Nikhil. Waiting for
your answer. Yes, sir, we can take.
Waiting for your answer. We can go for the assessment. This time the assessment will be quite individual one. Everyone will get different set of questions.
Okay, sir. No problem.
No problem. Saurabh Ghatge. What is the difference in the TCP protocol and UDP protocol? I have to be attentive. We are recording all our sessions. Yes, Saurav. No response. Rupali. Sujay Thakkar. Sujay Thakkar. Siddharth Patil. You must be nowadays aware with utilizing the online facilities. You can't avoid if all your campus interviews are in an online mode. You should be in a proper format, not necessarily in the presentable format, but technically you must be aware to utilize all those resources. For many of the colleges in Pune, already the campus interviews are started in the online mode. If you don't reply, the companies will not at all care for you. Isn't it true, Rasika? Rasika Kulkarni, Neeraj Andure, I think everyone is busy in doing some other task. Divesh?
Yes, sir.
What's your opinion? Everybody should be aware. Should now properly utilize the online resources or not?
Yes, yes.
Huh?
Yes, they should be.
They should. Say for the colleges such as PICT, COEP, already the online interviews are starting. For PICT, almost 4 companies already have taken the campus interviews. If you are not properly aware to utilize the online platform, then it would be very difficult for you. I think we stop at this note only for today.